Well, good afternoon. I think the students here may know who I am, but for those who are watching the broadcast, I'm Steve Knapp, president of George Washington University, and it's really a pleasure to welcome you to today's first class in a series entitled Reflections on the Federal Reserve and Its Place in Today's Economy, featuring the chairman of the Federal Reserve, Dr. Ben Bernanke. I'm pleased to acknowledge that we have with us two of the university's trustees, Nelson Carbonell and Mark Schenkman, and also a number of faculty members are here in the audience, and some of them will be teaching later in the series. Today's the first university lecture series delivered by a sitting chairman of the Federal Reserve, and I think it does provide an extraordinary opportunity for the students who are here in the classroom, but also for those watching online. They'll have an opportunity to gain insight into the nation's central banking system and a wide range of issues that affect this country and the world. I do want to say that there are microphones available for the students, and certainly encourage you, when the chairman's lecture is over, to avail yourself of those, and we hope there'll be a lively exchange of questions and answers at the end of the lecture. It's now a distinct honor to introduce the chairman of the Board of Governors of the Federal Reserve System, Dr. Ben Bernanke. Dr. Bernanke took office in 2006 and is now serving his second term as chairman. He also serves as chairman of the Federal Reserve's Open Market Committee. Before his appointment as chairman, Dr. Bernanke was involved with the Federal Reserve in several roles, as a member of the Board of Governors, as a visiting scholar, and as a member of the Academic Advisory Panel at the Federal Reserve Bank of New York. He also served as chairman of the President's Council of Economic Advisors from June 2005 to January 2006. Now, Chairman Bernanke is no stranger to academia. He's been a faculty member at Princeton, Stanford, and New York University, as well as the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. He's held a Guggenheim and a Sloan Fellowship, and is a fellow of the Econometric Society and the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. Chairman Bernanke received a Bachelor of Arts from Harvard University and a PhD from MIT. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Chairman of the Federal Reserve, Dr. Ben Bernanke.
Thank you very much, President Knapp. Gee, this is great. This is what I used to do before I got in this line of work for 23 years, and I've always enjoyed engaging with college students, so thank you for being here, and I hope we do have a good conversation. Let me particularly thank President Knapp and Professor Fort and George Washington University. As everybody here knows, these lectures are part of a real course, and after I get off the scene, there'll be other professors talking about other aspects of the Fed, and you'll hear different points of view, which is great. And you'll have to do some papers and all kinds of things, and I'm gonna read a few of the papers, so I look forward to doing that. I'll be talking from slides, which is in part for the purpose of making this available to others who might be interested. These slides will be posted on the Federal Reserve's website, federalreserve.gov, as we go through. And so if you need extra copies, or by all means do that. And as President Knapp said, I'm going to be talking for a while from the presentation, but at the end I hope we can have some questions and answers. So when we get started. So what I want to talk about in these four lectures is the Federal Reserve and the financial crisis. Now, my thinking about this is very much conditioned by my experience as an economic historian. I think when you talk about the issues that just occurred over the last few years, it makes the most sense to think about it in the broader context of central banking as it's taken place over the centuries. So even though we're going to be focusing a good bit of the lectures, particularly next week, on the financial crisis and how the Fed responded, I think we need to go back and look at the broader context. So as we talk about the Fed, we'll be talking about the origin and mission of central banks in general. And we're looking at previous financial crises, most notably the Great Depression, and see how that informed the Fed's actions and decisions in the recent crisis. So let me just give you a roadmap of the four lectures. Today, lecture one, we won't touch on the current crisis at all. Instead, we'll talk about what central banks are, what they do, how central banking got started in the United States, and we'll do some history. We'll talk about how the Fed engaged with its first great challenge, the Great Depression of the 1930s. The second lecture on Thursday will take up the history, we'll review developments in central banking and with the Federal Reserve after World War II, talking about the conquest of inflation, the Great Moderation, and other developments that occurred after World War II. But we'll spend a good bit of time in lecture two, talking about the build-up to the crisis and some of the factors that led to the crisis of 2008-2009. Then next week, we'll get into the more recent events. In lecture three, we'll talk about the intense phase of the financial crisis, its causes, its implications, and particularly the response to the crisis by the Federal Reserve and by other policymakers. And then in the final lecture, lecture four, we'll look at the aftermath. We'll talk about the recession that followed the crisis, the policy response of the Fed, including monetary policy, the broader response in terms of changes in financial regulation, and a little bit of a forward-looking discussion about how this experience will change how central banks operate and how the Federal Reserve will operate going forward. So this is our topic today, is origins and missions of the Federal Reserve. So let's talk in general about what a central bank is. If you've had some background in economics, you know that a central bank is not a regular bank, it's a government agency, and it stands at the center of the monetary and financial system of a country. Central banks are very important institutions. They have helped to guide the development of modern financial systems, modern monetary systems, and they play a major role in economic policy. Now, we've had various arrangements over the years, but today, virtually all countries have central banks. The Federal Reserve in the United States, the Bank of Japan in Japan, Bank of Canada, and so on. The main exception is only cases where you have what's called a currency union, where a number of countries collectively share a central bank. The most important example by far of that is the European Central Bank, which is central bank to 17 European countries who share the common currency, the euro. But even in that case, each of the participating countries does have its own central bank, which is part of the overall system of the euro. So central banks are now ubiquitous. Even the smallest countries typically have central banks. Now, this is a very important theme here. What do central banks do? What is their mission? And as I'll discuss throughout the lectures, it's convenient to talk about two broad aspects of what central banks do. The first is to try to achieve macroeconomic stability. And by that, I generally mean stable growth in the economy, avoiding big swings, recessions, and the like, and keeping inflation low and stable. So that's the economic function of a central bank. The other function of central banks, which is going to get a lot of attention, obviously, in these lectures, is the financial stability function. Central banks try to keep the financial system working normally, and in particular, they try to prevent, or if unsuccessful in preventing, they try to mitigate financial panics or financial crises. And I'll talk more about what those are. Now, what are the tools that central banks use to achieve these two broad objectives? Simple terms, there are basically two broad sets of tools. On the economic stability side, the main tool, as I'm sure everyone knows, is monetary policy. In normal times, the Fed, for example, can raise or lower short-term interest rates. It does that by buying and selling securities in the open market. In normal times, if the economy is growing too slowly or inflation is falling too low, the Fed can stimulate the economy by lowering interest rates. Lower interest rates feed through to a broad range of other interest rates. That encourages spending, acquisition of homes, for example, construction, investment by firms, borrowing. It just generates more demand, more spending, more investment in the economy, and that creates more thrust and growth. So that to stimulate an economy, you lower interest rates. And similarly, if the economy is growing too hot, if inflation is becoming a problem, then the normal tool of central bank is to raise interest rates. So by raising the overnight interest rate, known in the United States as the federal funds rate, higher interest rates feed through the system and help to slow the economy by raising the cost of borrowing, of buying a house, of buying a car, or of investing in capital goods, and that will slow the economy and reduce the pressure of overheating. So monetary policy is the basic tool that central banks have used for many, many years to try to keep the economy on a more or less even keel in terms of both growth and inflation. Now, a little less familiar is the main tool of central banks in dealing with financial panics or financial crises. And that tool is the provision of liquidity. So to address financial stability concerns, and for reasons I'll explain, one thing that central banks can do is make short-term loans to financial institutions. As I'll explain, providing short-term credit to financial institutions during a period of panic or crisis can help calm the market, can help stabilize those institutions, and can help mitigate or bring to an end a financial crisis. So this activity, which is an old one, as I'll discuss, is known as the lender of last resort tool. So again, if financial markets are disrupted, financial institutions don't have alternative sources of funding, then the central bank stands ready to serve as the lender of last resort, providing liquidity to the system and thereby helping to stabilize the financial system. Now there's a third tool which the Fed has had from the beginning and most central banks have, which is financial regulation and supervision. Central banks usually play a role in supervising the banking system, assessing the extent of risk on their portfolios, making sure their practices are sound, and in that way, trying to keep the financial system healthy. To the extent the financial system can be kept healthy and its risk-taking within reasonable bounds, then the chance of a financial crisis occurring in the first place is reduced. However, this activity, although come back to it, this is something which is not unique to central banks. In the United States, for example, there are a number of different agencies like the FDIC or the Office of the Control of the Currency that work with the Fed in supervising the financial system. So this is not unique to central banks, and so I'll be downplaying this for the time being and focusing on the two principal tools, monetary policy and lender of last resort activities.